Welcome to the Magic Formula for Video Post-Production presented by Pixelz. We're really excited today to get in and talk about a topic that a lot of us have been talking about for years. My name is Ryan Roberts. I'm the Customer Success Director for North America for Pixelz. My background has been in running some studios and prior to Pixelz, and in doing so, participated in quite a bit of video production. So I'm excited to dig into this topic today. Feel free to use the chat and post GIFs and emojis throughout the webinar. We really like the interaction. Also submit questions via the Q&A, and we will get to those at the end of the webinar. So let's, without further ado, introduce our two other guests. I'm going to bring Jacob and Mick onto the stage. Gentlemen, please join me. All right.
Hey, Ryan.
Hey, guys.
Hey, Ryan.
Hey, so why don't you guys go ahead and introduce yourselves, starting with Jacob, please.
Sure. Thank you, Ryan. Yes, my name is Jacob. I have the pleasure of being the COO at Pixelz, and I'm very happy to be on this webinar today talking about a super important topic. I'm heading up everything related to customer experience at Pixelz, including our products. So this is something I've been working with the team on for quite a while now. So we're very excited to be able to bring this to the market.
Awesome.
Yeah. All right, my name is Mick. I'm product manager here at Pixelz, or one of the product managers here at Pixelz. I've been with the company for a few years, recently joined the product team, but before that I was part of the team, the talent team we have out in Vietnam, was out there for a few years as well. And I'm now, as part of the product team, working with a few exciting projects, video being one of them.
Awesome. Well, just to kick things off, we'd love to take a quick poll of the audience and just find out who all is using video out there. Now, if you are using video, or if you're currently using it for your PDP, go ahead and give us a thumbs up. If you're in a testing or playing around, experimenting phase with video, give us a smiley face. And if you're just here to learn about video editing, you're kind of new to the subject, go ahead and give us a smiley face with glasses. I think those emojis are being posted so that you don't have to guess which ones I'm talking about. Let's go ahead and see, who all already is using this. Others. All right. We got some users, some testers. This is great. All right. Sweet. As I said, I have in my past life, prior to Pixelz, been involved with video production with PDP, and it was a hot topic about 10 years ago. I feel like it kind of was challenging and load times and things of that nature. But the fact is, we've been talking about this for a while, and now it's really coming, starting to boil up again. So I think before we get started, let's start with some hard facts about video. And I'm just going to rattle off some really impressive statistics about it, which is why I think that we're all interested in it. Numerous surveys have shown that video impacts conversion rates in a positive way and return rates where there are less returns. According to the Future of Commerce Trend Report by Shopify, those guys know a thing or two about e-commerce at Shopify. Their report last year said 46% of consumers want to watch product videos before buying. I mean, that's almost half of the market that they have. According to the Marketing Helpline, video posts on social media get 48% more views compared to traditional content. I mean, think about that. That's crazy. And then, not to mention on social media, how easy and more shareable a video is than, say, just some sort of text-heavy page or something of that nature. So then, according to Social Media Today, 74% of users who watched an explainer video about a product subsequently bought it. That's great conversion. 60% of consumers would rather watch a product video than read a description. I fall in that category. And finally, e-commerce product pages will convert 80% better than those without. And so those all go kind of hand in hand with what we all heard last week in Berlin at our Flow event when Adrian Sandu from Zalando gave his really impressive presentation about video editing at scale. And he said that they've been very proactively A/B testing video for a while now. And based on the results they're seeing, they've decided to make a major push in product videos. So Jacob, is now a good time to get into video?
It seems like it, right? I don't think we need to take our word for it. And I think of course we've been seeing this for years. I remember we had video production, as far back as like 7-8 years ago, with a few clients, and then that got shut down because the need just went away. There's no doubt that we've seen like an increasing interest, especially in the last couple of years, and it just seems to be continuing in this. And we're seeing more and more clients move into this that have, made their business cases internally, that got the budget signed off, that got everything in place to be able to do this and scale it. And obviously, Zalando is spearheading this, you can say, at least in the European market. So it's really interesting to see how many are going to follow and how fast, because we with what the interest we're seeing, we have no doubt that's what's happening.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, just to piggyback on that, I think one of the reasons that it is circling back is the social media aspect of it. Now, all of a sudden, everyone has more channels to distribute these videos as opposed to just their website. So that being said, we're all here to talk about it. Let's talk about some best practices. We have been talking to quite a number of our customers. We've talked to a number of attendees throughout the last few Flow events, including last week's in Berlin. And we've been hearing some best practices when it comes to production that help streamline the entire process. And Mick, I was hoping that maybe you could go through some of the things we've been hearing from our customers and others.
Yeah, sure, Ryan. Thanks. So of course we are first and foremost a post production company. So our focus is maybe a little bit biased towards that side of the of production. But of course there's so many different things that you could talk about, some logistics and so on. But as I mentioned, being a post production company, I think I'll focus a little bit on the elements that goes into shooting the videos that can make an impact down the post production track of things. Video shooting videos is not super different from shooting images in the sense of like there's some good practices that needs to be upheld. And one thing that was a big topic also at the Flow event last week, and also something that we hear from clients is that color consistency is extremely important when dealing with product materials. The objective, of course, is to make sure we do accurate representations of the product. It has to look really, really good, but it has to still be accurate, of course. So one thing that has brought up that is maybe sometimes forgotten is using color checkers, especially if you're in a fast-paced studio, lots of things moving around. A camera might be swapped around, or they might be busy with some sets. Someone might go borrow your lights. So bringing in the color checker from time to time, making sure that the camera is calibrated, can really go a long way to make sure that you get a very good color representation of the video that you are shooting. So I think that's sort of like back to the basics, but that would be sort of like the first highlight to bring in. And I think going on from there. Having sort of like a dedicated shooting setup for video can help as well. So making sure that you have a specific camera or specific cameras that you're shooting with, having the same lights that you're shooting with, having the same environment around the videos, so that you don't end up with different color balances, white balance, and so on. We have seen from time to time that a photographer maybe goes and borrow a camera over the weekend or something like that and comes back with the camera, and then all of a sudden all the videos are shot in a incorrect white balance. And especially when you're shooting video, you're often shooting in a very flat image profile. So once you're on set and things are like you're busy or set, you might not actually see that the color balance is off. But then you might get an angry editor sitting down the track trying to shift colors because everything is too cold or too warm, or even worse, green or magenta, right? So I think keeping a consistent setup, I think is really important when possible. Obviously, different studios have different sizes, different amount of equipment, but if you're able to, then I would definitely say keep a dedicated setup around the video. In that regards, it's also a very good way, a good idea to, or something that we've heard at least some of our clients do, is that they try to keep the sets for video really close to the sets for the stills, which is for logistic reasons very practical. So you could essentially, you could style the talent, get them dressed, then you can have them do the poses for the stills, and then essentially just walk next door or around the corner, whatever it is, but walk directly onto the video set where you could then continue the shooting. Obviously, that makes a lot of sense logistically. You don't have to, the talent doesn't have to wait. You don't have to do like a restyling and try to see if you can match consistency. So unless you, so if you have one location where you do all production, then I would definitely say that trying to keep things close to each other is definitely a good idea. Another thing that came up, that has come up with some of our clients is that some clients have actually employed, you can say, dedicated Digitech members into their production. And a Digitech person is someone that is sort of like a technical assistant to the photographer. So they work side by side they work in the background on set, make sure that all the captured stills and videos are collected and consolidated, and also color references and all this stuff is brought together. So they take care of all the offloading of files and ingesting into internal systems and make sure that everything is like packed up neatly. And again, this just helps make sure that you don't end up with like having to look for files. And it means that also you can kind of hand over all assets in a nice way to post-production. And depending on the setup, if you have an in-house team or if you are sourcing out to a partner, that is definitely something that can help speed up the process instead of having the photographer having to do it and interrupt the process, or the photographer having to do it in a batch at the end of the day. So logistically, it also makes a lot of sense as well.
I think, Mick, it's fair to say that Digis are often the unsung heroes of the studio, right?
Yeah, exactly. I didn't know that they existed before we kind of heard about it in terms of this video thing. Right. So,
yeah, they really help with the asset flow and just making sure everything stays on track and keeps moving down, you know, downstream. And what I'm kind of hearing, you know, from all of this is that, you know, color, consistency, and efficiency are really important factors. You know, we also heard, you know, keeping the lighting consistent between the stills and the videos. You know, obviously they're all going to live on the same PDP page. And so as much as you can mimic the lighting, and that's in both color temperature, but also in modifiers, you know, and sometimes that becomes the biggest challenge, at least in my past experience, is, you know, keeping that lighting consistent using different lighting tools. But I mean, I think you would agree, Mick, there's been, you know, just a huge expansion in LED lighting and the capabilities, and as a result, you know, the cost has come down with that. You know, it's become much more affordable and allowed, you know, for more people to get into video in a less expensive manner, so to speak.
On that note, Ryan, so I'm gonna jump in here, but I'm just thinking about a very big studio I visited last year in London by a very, very well-known established brand that are running, they're basically running continuous lighting across the entire studio with, and basically their stills and the video next to each other. So they do the stills first, basically go over, start the video camera, and then the model does the job. She knows exactly, or they know exactly what to do. Do the spin, the in and out, and onto the next product. And like having that in the same set, same control environment, I haven't seen that before. I have to say that was the next level and very interesting. And I think we're gonna see you know, versions like this come up more and more. Obviously, investing in transforming your studio like this is a heavy upfront investment, and you need to really want this and have a vision for what you want. But I think there's a lot of efficiencies in doing it like this.
Yeah, and I mean, that really speaks to the lighting getting better, but also the cameras getting better.
Yes.
Because now stills can actually be shot at a higher ISO, which allows you to shoot with this continuous lighting and not necessarily have the need for the really intense strobes to freeze it at 100 ISO. So I think just, you know, technology and the advancement of the tools really is aiding in the things that we're discussing as far as consistency and efficiencies. Mick, I think it's worth noting right now, you know, when you're editing, do you want to be sweeping the floor in post-production, or should that happen maybe in production?
Yeah, right. No, I'm glad you brought it up, Ryan. I think, you know, there's a lot of similarities between the photos and videos, but I think one of the key differences here is motion, right? And doing cleaning up a dirty background or removing markers or unwanted equipment is not really a problem in Photoshop. It takes seconds, right? But when you are working in video, you have moving subjects, then it becomes more of like a tedious task. And maybe not the best time, not the best way to spend time. You know, the time spent versus value is, you know, obviously there's a high value in not having the marks, which they wouldn't have been there, but compared to just sweeping the floor or peeling off a sticker or moving a C stand a little bit, I think it goes a long way to help your friends over at editing.
Attention to detail in production. What have we heard, you know, about, you know, creating, you know, standards and kind of, you know, I hate to use it, but formulas to a certain extent.
So we can talk a little bit more about it as we talk about the editing part as well. But for sure, you know, keeping a standard setup for your set, you know, have a specific approach to how you, you know, shoot the videos is something we hear that our clients are focusing on, because obviously, quite often, you know, studios have a lot of garments they need to go through and other products to go through. And if you have to spend a lot of time figuring out where to start and, you know, where should the talent move to and all this stuff, it's not really efficient, and it might also create chaos and, you know, in the process. So creativity is of course good, but it should be constrained creativity, right? So definitely a good idea to have a standard approach to these videos.
And then how does, you know, let's take that from production and start going into post-production, which is, you know, where we kind of step in, you know, like what are some, you know, helpful elements beyond production, but that would help in the post-production side of these videos?
Right. So I think when it comes to preparing for the post-production, you really want to make sure that you are that you have a clear defined style guide, as you could call it, for 40 videos. So making sure that you know exactly what clips you need. Typically for these videos, for like a PDP video, we see something like a full body shot, then a semi-crop, focusing on the top or the bottom, depending on what garment that is being shot, moving into a one or two details, highlights, and then ending back on a full body shot, something like that. And really defining that and also defining some standard set of moves. Sorry, I have a little bit of background noise here. Defining a set of standard moves, best practice for the models, kind of really helps everyone kind of stay on track. It makes it a lot easier in post-production. The editor would know what kind of tips to look for. And in the same way, the talents that are maybe not used to being in front of a video camera, usually doing stills, also has much more confidence in how they should move. So try and work on defining exactly what clips that you want, and also have sort of like an overall direction for what type of moves you want. Are you looking for something a bit serious, or are you sort of looking for something where it's okay with a bit of personality in them? And you know, to what extent can the model be looking around and all these things? So basically, writing out like an ideal storyboard for these videos is a really good idea.
Which all just plays into the theme that we're hearing over and over again: consistency, right? And so I think this is where it gets exciting for us, right? Like this is where we get to talk about what we are launching and what, you know. So I'm going to let Jacob run with this a little bit. So Jacob, tell us a little bit about video post production at Pixelz.
Sure. I think first of all, in general, what we're trying to do when we're developing, you know, new products and our services as a whole is to try to solve a problem. We're not sitting in a basement trying to make up a problem that may be in the industry and for our clients, but really listening to them. And so, of course, video has been a topic for a few years now. It's been something we've kept tabs on, like I mentioned previously, and now it's kind of been escalating. So around a year ago, we decided to go into this, and because we felt like there was a growing demand, there was a growing pain around you know, producing videos at scale and handling post production in that process. So we teamed up with a couple of our bigger clients and basically started building out you know, the desirable process that can scale and deliver back the images and the videos that our clients needed. And I think overall, high level, you can say that our vision is really to provide our clients and with high quality and affordable video editing services. And at the same time, we want to make it easy for our clients to really create some engaging and professional looking videos, because we know that that's something that they need, and they need to be able to do this at a faster pace than before. There's way more channels to serve than ever before. You know, a few years ago we talked about social media as being a channel, and now, you know, you can't talk about social media as a whole. You need to talk about TikTok, you need to talk about Instagram, Facebook, etc., as separate channels where you need to have a strategy for that, and that requires a lot for handling that in post production and managing those processes. So we're trying to encompass all those different challenges and really creating, you know, a simple way of solving those needs in our platform. And then I think one of the core things, and we talk about color consistency and just consistency in production, is that we are really trying to create like a one place to handle, you know, the entire content need that they have. So be able to basically handle a full PDP for a client with both their images and their videos and maybe even different types of videos and images within that same SKU or within the same production, and be able to handle that in one place, be able to review that in one place, be able to communicate that about that in one place. And of course, get consistency across your editing, across your colors, for instance, which we know has been a major pain point, because typically our clients would be doing this in separate processes and maybe using Pixelz for one thing and then handle the video somewhere else or in-house and so on. It could just be really, really difficult to manage those types of productions when they're not, you know, handled in one place where you have a single source of truth. So I think that's in essence what we would try to do with our clients. And so I hope that answered your question, Ryan. I could talk about this all day, you know.
I do know that. let's talk about some of the needs that we are seeing, though. I mean, they range from PDP to what is being described as EPDP. And we're also seeing, you know, PDP being, you know, very informative and more in line with, you know, descriptive, showing the way things move. And then we are also seeing, you know, the EPDP, where it's about creating, you know, some like some inspiration and some, you know, a feel for the brand. So, you know, can you speak to, you know, some of the needs that we're seeing out there in regards to those categories or any others that you may have been seeing?
Yeah, Of course, I think it's actually, I mean, it's the way we look at this is more or less one-to-one what we're seeing on the image side of things. And oftentimes because it is one-to-one in production, because if you're producing an elevated image that like you're saying is selling maybe a bit more of a feel than just providing product information, then you need to mimic that on your video. Then you can't just do your walk in, walk out. You need to have it a bit more playful in there and so on. So I think that's part of the style guide and you know the you can say the strategy and what you want with your brands or your campaigns and so on. So I think they are very closely linked, and I think that may also makes a lot of sense in post production. So, but you're right. Like I think that the most typical that we probably all have seen is your walk in, walk out, like a pretty simple video and a fairly simple edit as well. And then, you know, it's ranging, you know, we're seeing more and more of this, of these more elevated videos, as you're saying, a bit more playfulness, a bit more creativity. Also like we're seeing on the image side. And then of course it spans all the way up to, you know, from through teasers to campaign and editorial work, just like we're seeing on images. So it really spans pretty widely. But I will say within e-com, the typical use case is probably, this is just a number, right? But I think around 80% is probably, you know, focusing on your what we would call PDP and your more elevated PDP. I think that's where the main focus is. And also where you can get that, it's easy to control the consistency. It's easier to scale it. So I think it's also a great place to start. And then over time, you could potentially start testing out with, you know, with some different types of productions.
Absolutely. Well, being aware of the time, I think we should probably go over to some questions. So let's take a look here. So we have Sarah Lee asking, what does ePDP stand for? So you guys want to go ahead and explain that?
Sure. Yeah, and sorry for using a few of these abbreviations. When you say it enough times, then it just becomes your second nature. But it stands for elevated, and typically something that at least at Pixelz, and I know from quite a few of our clients are talking about when you're taking your PDP, your more standard PDP, and try to elevate the production and the aesthetic of your images or videos. In this case, that's typically what you would talk about as being an elevated PDP or elevated e-commerce.
Awesome. And then
and the PDP is your product description page or product display page.
Right. Yeah. then we have Roland asking, what steps, procedures are they using to ensure color luma consistency for a brand across different production and post-production venues? So I'm gonna, Mick, can you tackle that one?
I am not sure I have all the answers, to be honest. but of course, there's different tools that can be used. You can synchronize some equipment. You can use light meters and so on. But if there is someone has a very specific approach to this, it's outside of my experience. As I started by saying, I'm more on the post production side of things. So I don't have a brilliant answer for that one.
No, but that is a great question, because, you know, as we've been talking about, consistency is really important here and across the different productions, and especially the venues. That seems like we should figure out the answer to that one. And then Jacob, I think there is a big need, and this is a question from Jacob. I think there's a big need for a tethered video workflow, similar like using Capture One for photos, to make QC and file handling easier. Do you know any solutions on the market for this? I personally do not, but I do agree that, especially with the file sizes and the amount of data, that if you could just port it straight into a big hard drive, or even better, a server, that would make a lot of sense. And not to mention just being able to see everything up on a large screen. But I don't know if you gentlemen happen to know of anything, but I'm not aware of anything.
There is one solution that is actually quite cool, which we have looked a little bit into. It's called frame.io. It's a plugin that works with DaVinci Resolve editing. And they have this capture to cloud. They support different external recorders for video. I think if you look up frame.io and look at, I believe they call it cloud capture or capture to cloud or something along those lines. Then you see, and if you use one of the supported external recorders, then you can actually send directly from the camera to the cloud, and then it's just the files are stored on frame.io, and then you can actually access them directly in DaVinci Resolve. There's a few other ones as well. I can't remember the names, but I think frame.io is definitely the sexiest of them. So it does exist.
Okay, awesome. And then I think the last question here is, what's the primary difference from an ePDP to a standard PDP? And I think, you know, this can be both images and video, really. And so, Jacob, I'll let you tackle that one.
Yeah, again, a very good question. And honestly, I think there are very blurred lines when it comes to these different definitions. And I think you can talk to 100 different brands that will give you 100 different definitions on. Yeah. It is very much related to the individual brand and how they perceive this. You would have one brand that is called their standard PDP, would for another brand be elevated PDP. And if you look at the standard PDP for Sarah, for some brands, that will be campaign work. So you know, I think it's hard to box it in, but sometimes it helps us, you know, to at least separate some of the different concepts. And I think maybe look at like ePDP as being something that is very highly standardized, and where every day in and out you shoot it in the same way. There's very little flexibility on set. You don't give a lot of creativity or creative freedom to your stylists, to your models, to your photographers or videographers. You really follow a very clear playbook. Whereas when it comes to the more elevated, that's where you loosen up a little bit on the frame of this. Maybe you allow your team to go on location and shoot this and play around with this, use different types of props, different color backdrops, you know. You loosen up a little bit and give some creative freedom back to the team. And I know we have some clients that are actually leveraging this when it's not rainy outside and you have a sunny day. Maybe you go outside and do some shoots, you know, in front of a food truck or a dumpster or something, mm-hmm. especially if you have that kind of street you know, kind of look. So I think that would be the main difference, where it doesn't have to be a campaign for you to shoot outside, for instance. So I think I hope that adds a bit more context to at least how we perceive it.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, that is from the production standpoint. And I think that there's also an element to it from the post-production standpoint of, you know, standard PDP from a post-production standpoint is pretty formulaic. You know, walk in, clip the ends, balance the car, you know, get the color right. But you know, some of the work that we've been working on that we would classify internally for video post production, you know, requires really getting in there and isolating things to do color management on it, different types of cuts that aren't as formulaic in it. And it's really about creating a feel, but it is definitely an elevated post-production process. So I think that, you know, there's a couple of different ways to look at it. But, it, you know, generally speaking, you know, PDP tends to be more simplistic. Whereas ePDP, both from a production or post-production, tends to be more creative and less formulaic. But you know, as Jacob said, you can talk to 100 brands and get 100 different definitions of it. But generally speaking, it's, you know, simplistic and versus, you know, creative. And I think we're out of time. So unless there's any more questions, I think we're out of time. So this would be a good time to thank everybody for taking the time to come listen to, you know, what we had to say about video. And we'd love to hear any feedback that you all have. We are very big on feedback, or, you know, if there's anything we didn't cover that you wanted to discuss further, we'd love to have you, you know, let us know. And also, if you want to go and learn more about Pixelz video, if you'll check out pixelz.com /video, you will see the landing page and learn more about what we are doing in the video category. And so at this point, I think we'd like to just say goodbye and thank you. And we'll see you on the next one.
Thanks all.
Bye, guys.
Thank you.